Well, good evening. It's good to see you tonight. We'll start with a good old hymn. If you stand to your feet, we'll start with page. We're going to start 167, I thought I said. Yes, page 167 on our hymnal, Joy Unspeakable. Amen. I hope you have it. It's the joy of the Lord. Stand to your feet. Amen.
His grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. While I sit and learn at Jesus' feet, I am free, yes, free indeed. In His joy unspeakable,
service, amen, besides the audio system. Now, you know what? It's funny, because, you know, sometimes when the audio system messes up, everybody just stares at the audio guys back here. It wasn't their fault. It wasn't their fault, amen. They actually fixed it, amen. Thank you guys for fixing that this morning. And I was like, Lord, if it keeps doing that, we're going to have a heart attack in here, amen. But I'm glad it got fixed, amen. And they reset everything. But good to see you tonight. Thank you being here. And we are honored that you're here tonight. Let's close. We're not going to close. We're going to open in prayer. Amen. And ask God to be with us. Amen. Dear God, we thank you for this day of giving us. We thank you for loving us. And Lord, we pray that you bless our service tonight. And I pray that you would be glorified and praised. We thank you how good you've been here at Fair Havens. And Lord, I pray that you continue to bless, continue to touch for God. Thank you for the one that joined this morning. And Lord, we pray that you would just do great, mighty things here in the future. Lord, I pray that your spirit will be felt tonight. And Lord, that you would do only that which you can do. We pray all these things in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
There is not a brother, sister, friend, or brother.
forsaken, that he will not love you. And what's amazing, he loves me too. And I'm glad. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's turn to page 177 on our hymnal. If you're using one, if you can use the boards, electronic boards, also it's good. Yeah. Page 177. Are you washed in the blood? Amen. For with and without the blood, there is no remission of sins. It's how important the blood of Jesus is for our salvation. Amen.
Have you been to Jesus' cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you holy, cleansing and His grace to shine? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed?
I like that second verse. I hope you do as well. Second verse of 177. Are you all ready?
Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb, are your garments spotless, either white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
On the fourth,
lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood?
in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless like the white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Amen. All right, you may be seated. Come on, ushers, at this time. And let me give you a couple announcements. We will not be having Bible study tomorrow night, and we'll postpone that to next month. We look forward to that. Teenagers will be having a bonfire on the 18th. For more information, you see Brother Alex or Miss Rachel, and they do that. I just attend that stuff, amen, and they figure all that stuff out. Next church soul winning, we put on November 2nd. We're going to start doing that every 2 weeks, and because everybody wants to go out soul winning. Praise God. That's exciting. So we'll go out every other week, outdoor knocking. And I want to again thank you so much, everybody outdoor knocking yesterday. A good crowd. We got a lot of doors knocked, amen, and met a lot of folks. Thank you again so much for that. Brother Bob led someone to the Lord. That's a blessing, amen, and praise God for that. And then don't forget, men, November 8th and 9th, the Swords Men's Conference over there. If you want to go to that, costs us $25. Some tremendous speakers over there, so you'll look forward to that. And then November the 20th, we're going to have a church-wide Thanksgiving meal. Now, this is on a Wednesday night, and because all of our kids are over there, we want our kids to be a part of this. So we're going to feed you a Thanksgiving meal on November 20th, amen, and we look forward to that. So November 20th, we'll have a Thanksgiving meal over there, and we'll join the kids over there, and we'll join their service over there that night, amen, and show those kids how much we love them and appreciate them, and what a blessing, amen. And I was thinking about this today. Let's not forget our missionaries, amen. And we support 15 missionaries around here, and I'm looking forward to God to increasing that here soon. I believe a heartbeat of a church should be missions, amen. And we go out into our area, and but we also need to help folks out in the world, amen. We support missionaries all around the world, in the States, but also foreign countries too. And so don't forget about your missions giving as well. And you give and you give, and I promise you God will bless with that. Amen. Adrian, won't you bless the offering, please, sir? We got a special for you tonight. Miss Sharon, you going to sing some for us? All right, Miss Sharon's going to come sing for us at time. And I know it'll be a blessing to you. Amen. Appreciate her. She's faithful. Amen. I appreciate faithful people. You know, appreciate people that's here every service. And she is, and I greatly appreciate that.
Thank you. shall be bright. Goodbye forever to her stark night. Change in a moment like him to be. Oh, glorious daybreak, Jesus will see. Some golden daybreak, Jesus will come. Some golden daybreak, battles are won. He'll shout the victory, break through the blue. Some golden daybreak for me, for you.
Going to happen. He'll come for me and he'll come for you. Amen. What a blessing. Amen. Good to see you this morning. Good crowd this morning. And we're excited to have another Robinson in the group. Amen. Praise God. And so I just told him, I said, he said, call me Ernest Ray. And I said, I'm just going to call you Rachel's daddy. And he just laughed. And a lot of folks, you know, it's amazing when you get kids, you lose your name. I mean, you literally do. You lose your name. I remember everybody called me Brother Redden or Pastor Redden, all this. Then all of a sudden, as my kids got older, it's, oh, you're Caitlin's daddy. Or you're Andrew's daddy. And I said, Pastor Redden. Oh, no, you're Caitlin's daddy. And I said, okay. So you lose your name when you get kids. And now I love being called Rosemary's grandfather. I think that's great, amen. And have you seen the picture of Rosemary with the chickens? How have you seen that? You got to go on Facebook, okay, and watch my granddaughter with the chickens, okay? Because I always wanted, when I got those chickens, I told Caitlin, I said, I'm going to look forward to one day that my granddaughter's going to be out here, and she's going to walk around with those chickens and pet on them. And they took me that, showed me that video of that, and I said, there you go, right there, praise God. And they followed her all around that yard, and if you see her, she's slapping at the chickens. So we got to teach her not to slap at the chickens, amen. And but I thought that was a blessing. Amen. Well, what a blessing it is. Thought about this. I have been the pastor here at Fairhaven's Independent Baptist Church for a whole month. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. And, hey, we've seen God do some great things. Amen. We've seen some sick people fixed. And praise God. We got one person that joined the church since I joined, since I became the pastor. We look forward to many people joining here in the future. We look forward to seeing all the pews filled up. Amen. Sunday school classes filled up. Buses filled up. We look forward to great and mighty things, amen, and thank you for being faithful, amen. And so guess what? It is Sunday night, and so what do we do on Sunday night? We give a biblical joke, praise God. I know they might be corny, but y'all smile, and that's worth it, amen. First one, Brother George might even get to us, and amen. Why didn't Noah go fishing? Why didn't Noah go fishing? He only had two worms. All right, some of you laughed, amen. Second one, what animal could Noah not trust? What animal could Noah not trust? Think about it. He couldn't trust a cheetah. Praise God, amen. Amen. Y'all got them tonight, praise God. Huh? That's a dad joke, amen. Yes. Amen. They're corny biblical jokes, amen. But it's okay. Y'all laugh. That's all that matters, amen. Praise God, amen. All right. I want you to think, and one more. Who was the biggest sinner in the Bible? Who was the biggest sinner in the Bible? I thought this one was pretty funny. Anybody guess who was the biggest sinner in the Bible? It was Moses. He broke all the commandments at the same time. Praise God, amen. Some of you laughed about that one, amen. All right, let's finish up. We did this morning, Ephesians chapter number four. All right. You know what? The Bible says laughter is medicine, amen, and what it is. And sometimes we get to laugh at each other. Praise God. It's even nice, too, amen. And I was thinking about Bob this morning, and he was out there talking, and he said that he was on a ladder this week, and he fell. And I said, what are you doing on a ladder at 73 years old? He said, I got to do something. And he said, you know, he was talking about how that last step just wasn't there, and he fell down. And I said, you know what? If I did that and somebody was around, I bet they would have laughed at me. And he said, his wife didn't laugh at him. She went over and took care of me. Amen. But I think about this laughter. How that laughter is so needed in our hearts. It's so needed in our hearts. There's so much bad, there's so much evil going on in this world today that we just need a laugh, amen? It does, a merry heart doeth good like medicine, amen? And I encourage you this, won't you find you a friend that you can laugh with, okay? I mean, won't you find you a friend you can enjoy being around and you make each other laugh, amen? Me and my wife make each other laugh because we say the things that, you know, and I'll say, I did that, and she said, well, that's not good. And what makes her laugh is when I'm typing something, and I don't claim to be the good, greatest typer in the world or writing something. Now, if you read my sermons, the words are all messed up, but I can read it, praise God, it's all that matters. But if she's dictating one of my notes that I'm writing to somebody, and she's just in there laughing, and I said, is it that bad? She said, and you went to college? So I went to Bible college, amen. That's it, amen. I did take English, amen. All right, Ephesians chapter 4 and verse number 22. If you're there, say amen. All right, the Bible says that ye put off concerning the former conversation the old man, which is corrupt concerning deceitful lust, and be renewed by the spirit of your mind, that ye put on the new man, which is after God created in righteousness and true holiness. Wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be ye angry and sin not. Let the sun go down upon your wrath. Neither give place to the devil. I want you to understand that. It says neither give place to the devil. Listen to this. That's very important in your life, that you don't ever give place to the devil. We live in a wicked, wicked, wicked world. Don't ever give place to the devil. You know why? The devil will stick his foot in the door anytime he can get, amen. Why? Because he wants to destroy the life of a Christian. Oh, if you can get away from the devil, amen. Do not let the devil have place. Then it says, let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands, the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but it was as good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And then verse number 32, and be ye kind one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Let's pray. Dear Lord God, we thank you this day. Pray that you bless our sermon tonight, Lord God. I pray that it be your words, not my words. Lord, I pray that you speak to hearts, Lord God. Thank you for your people that are here. Lord, I pray that you be glorified and lifted up. And Lord, that you be honored in everything that we do here at Fair Havens. Lord, thank you for our visitors tonight. And thank you for everyone that's here. Thank you for the one that joined this morning. And we pray that you would just continue to grow our ministry here at the church, Lord God. And I pray that you be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, we talked about the fact is that your walk matching up to your talk. And we talked about being credible. Credibility. You know, as a child of God, people are looking for credibility in you. It's so important. They're looking for credibility. They're looking for the real thing. They're looking to see if you're real or not. Why? Because there's a lot of fake knockoffs. And I want you to think about this. I thought about this, and I'll preach this a couple weeks when it says about being followers of me, that we imitate something. And there's also imitation stuff. You know what I'm talking about? Those little knockoff stuff. I mean, there's a bunch of people that knock off purses and all those expensive purses. And I thought about this. Growing up, we never had any money. I mean, we had all the cheap stuff. I mean, we had all hand-me-downs from my cousins. I had everything. And I remember one time I got this cheap pair of shoes, okay? Got this cheap pair of shoes. And I said, you know what? Man, I would just love to have a pair of Nike shoes. I mean, with that little check mark. Man, if you had a pair of shoes with those check marks on it, man, you was all that. You was the stuff. You was the stuff. But none of my shoes had a check mark on. My shoes are literally like the plastic bottom shoes. You know what I'm talking about? You ever wore a plastic bottom shoe? That's what I grew up with. I mean, I would fall there 5 seconds when things are so slick, amen. And I remember I got a pair of white plastic bottom shoes. And I remember I said, you know, I'm going to do this. I'm going to put me a Nike swoosh on that thing. So I took me a permanent marker, and oh, man, I drew me a Nike swoosh on that thing. I was going to have me some Nikes. And I was so proud of those things, and I went through school. It's kind of like, hey, look at this. I got some Nikes on. And all the kids stopped and looked at me and laughed and said, that is the worst imitation I've ever seen of a pair of Nike shoes. I was so proud of them. Man, everybody made fun of me that day. They said, you're just having a knockoff. That's a knockoff. You're not, they don't even look the same. And they laughed at me. But you know, as a child of God, we should look the same as Christ. I mean, we should look the same. And people know when we're not looking the same. People know when we're not a follower of Christ. You know why? Because if you're a follower of Christ, the Bible says that you'll be a peculiar person. And if you're not a peculiar person, that means you're not a follower of Christ. That means there's something different about you. And when I put that check mark on those shoes, they seen right through that. And listen to this. People see right through you. You see what I'm saying? People see right through you if you're not real. They'll see right through you. Why? Because one situation, and if you're not real, you'll say, oh, woe is me, and how bad life is, instead of praising God, how good it is. I thought about this one song when I was I'm not going to sing to you because I've got it rough right now because of things. But the song says, when I look around and see all the good things he's done for me, I know I'm unworthy of them all. His blessings he freely gives, I owe my life to him. I've got so much to thank him for. The chorus says, I've got so much to thank him for, so much to praise him for. You see, he has been good to me. When I think of all he's done and where he's brought me from, I've got so much to thank him for. And it says, and sometimes while on this way, I kneel and stop and say, Lord, thank you for all that you've done for me. And one day I'll reach heaven's sweet shore. Oh, please let me kneel once more. I've got so much to thank him more. Hey, listen to this. We've got so much to thank God for. Why can't we be real? Why can't we be the genuine thing? Why do we got to be an imitation thing? Why can't we just actually be real? Because the Bible says, a child of God, when God saved your soul, he made you a new creature. What does that mean? That means old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. You are a new creature in Christ. And when God saved my soul at the age of 16 years old, hey, he did a work in my life. I've never been the same since. Hey, I'm still a sinner saved by the grace of God. I still mess up. I still sin. But hey, listen to this. When he saved my soul, he put his spirit inside of me. And listen to this. Hey, he directs me. He guides me. And he tells me what to do. And listen to this. As a child of God, we ought to walk like we should. Our talk should match up with our walk. And listen to this. You want to be something for God? You ain't got to be nothing special. But listen to this. Oh, but God blesses a Christian that is real. He blesses a Christian that is real. We talked about credibility. It evolves your authority and is affected by your actions, attitudes, and aims. It is the consistency of your character and the firmness of the faithfulness effect of your credibility. Listen to this. Your faithfulness goes a long way. Your faithfulness goes a long way in credibility. And I tell people all the time, hey, you ought to love being at church. And you know what? Hey, it's Wednesday night. Hey, I think we had like 60 folks here. Crowd kind of dwindled down a little bit tonight. That's okay. I still love you, amen. Praise God. I still love them. But you know what? Faithfulness. Why can't we give God just a little extra of our time? Now, I understand that some people have sickness and illness and things of that nature. I understand that. But you know what? True dedication is coming to church when you don't feel like it sometimes. True dedication to church is when you come to church because you know you need church. Because, listen to this, and I think about this, sometimes we come to church and he's like, man, they need me. They need me. Oh, man, they can't do anything without me. And that's true. A lot of you in here, you do a lot of work, and I greatly appreciate that, amen. I don't want to have to drive the bus. I don't want to have to teach the teenagers. I don't want to have to run the sound room, man. I don't want to have to clean the church. I don't want to have to do all that stuff. There's dear folks in here that do that. Praise God. Oh, but can I say this? And how that you need God. God don't need you. And I'm telling you that from the preacher from back. You need God. God can use anybody he wants to. But we get to serve God. It's not a burden to be the pastor of this church. I get to be the pastor of this church. I get to go, listen to this, I get to go outside and I get to go blow the leaves off the parking lot. And if it needs to be, I get to go clean the toilet at the church. Why? Because this is God's house. I get to serve him. Hey, I get to go out door knocking and visit people. I get to do all kinds of stuff. Why? Because God lets me do that. And as a child of God, it should be real in our hearts. We talked about this morning about walking circumspectly. Meaning that we need to be careful and we need to be an outlook in life. Listen, the Bible says be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. What does that mean? That means you need to be on the lookout all the time, because the devil is going to put something in your way. He's going to put a stumbling block in your way. He wants to keep you from coming to church. He wants you to keep from being a witness from somebody. He wants you to keep being a witness to a family member. He wants you to stop you being a witness from outside there. Why? The devil wants to stop anything that you're going to do. He wants to put a stumbling block in your way. The Bible says he is a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. He will put anything in your way. Do you know what the amazing thing about? The devil knows what affects you. He knows. He knows the temperament of you. That there's some things that may not bother you. I mean, listen, the Tennessee Titans losing today, it didn't bother me. It didn't bother me at all. Okay? Now, there's other things that bother me, okay? And the devil will get all over you and tell you how bad it is and how rough it is. He is seeking who he may devour. Oh, but listen to this, credibility. How is your credibility put around the people around you? Are you the one that's real? And I want you to think about this. Why is our credibility so important? Number one, listen to this. It's simple. It's because of the message of salvation. I bet Patrick is proud of me because I actually got to a point today. Amen. The message of salvation. Listen to this. We want to persuade others to trust in Christ, believe the gospel, lest they die and spend eternity in hell. The Bible says in John 3:36, he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth on the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. And you know what I think about this? And I was listening to a podcast last night, and I was reading this, and I was like, what's wrong with America? And they had like 10 pastors up there, And all these pastors were talking about what's wrong with America, and they was talking about the worldly things of America, like crime is bad, and drugs are bad, and alcohol bad, and all this stuff. And he said, what's wrong with America? And this one pastor gets up there and he says, y'all gonna not gonna like my answer. And they said, go ahead and tell us. He said, you know what's wrong with America? He said, it's the pastors. And I was like, oh, my. Okay, I'm listening. He said, it's the pastors. And he said, you know what's wrong with the pastors in America today? He said, there's no preaching on hell in the pulpits. He said, there's no preaching on hell in the pulpits. He said, we want to make everybody feel good. We want to make everybody feel loved. Yes, Jesus loves us, but there's also a thing called the wrath of God. And the Bible says this, listen to this. It says in Revelation 20:14, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire, and this is the second death. And whosoever was not written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. The Bible says in Matthew 10:28, and fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him that is able to destroy both the soul and the body in hell. You know what, may I say this? What we need is an understanding and a realization that there are people dying and going to hell, and hell is real. And listen to this, it needs to come from the pulpits of America. And when we pray, we need to be praying that God will fill the pulpits with America of preachers that will actually preach that hell is real and hell is hot and hell is for eternity. Why is it that we go out door knocking? Why is it we pass out tracts? Why? Because hell is a real place, and one day it'll all come to fruition, and it's going to happen. Hey, the Bible says in twinkling of eye, this thing's going to all be over. But listen to this. One day, people are going to start spending eternity in hell. And listen to this. Ages and ages and ages past, people have already started spending hell. But you know what it is? It's responsibility of the child of God. Listen to this. To give the gospel. That way people understand that hell is real. It's the message of salvation. Why is it that we should be credible in our walk with God? Because hell is a real place. I'm telling you, listen to this. I had a grandmother that let me know all the time that hell was real. She said, you grandkids need to get saved. I mean, she had no hesitation. And she said, you grandkids need to get saved. You're going to die and go to hell. She said, you've been around preaching. God ain't convicted you yet. I said, I'm good, Danny. I'm good. I mean, she didn't mind telling you. Why? Because she understood that hell is real. Hell is a real place. And listen to this. You know why? You know how we get these pews full? Is you understand that hell is a real place and people are dying and going to hell. People all around you are dying and going to hell. And you know what? You could be the witness. They might take that one track and open up that track and get the gospel. Why is it that our walk and our talk need to be the same? Because the message of salvation. Number two, you get to put this one up there too, amen. The message of the second coming. We want to persuade others, prepare for this coming, and to be ready for his return. The Bible says in Matthew 24:44, therefore, listen to this, be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not the Son of Man cometh. Oh, I love this verse in Titus 2:13. Looking for the blessed hope and a glorious appearing of a great God of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Oh, and then the Bible says, listen to this, in 1 Thessalonians 4:16. For the Lord himself to descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of an archangel and with the trumpet of God, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and that which remain shall caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall, listen to this, we ever be with the Lord. What does that mean? That means that Jesus Christ is coming again. And as a child of God, why should your walk and talk match up? Because we should be telling people Christ is coming soon. And listen to this. Oh, there's a, you know, among theologians, there's always that discussion, when is it going to happen? Are you a premillennialist? Are you a mid-tribulationist? Are you an odd?
I just don't think God's going to let us go through all that, okay? I'm a pre-tribulation, okay? I believe that God's not going to let us come through that, okay? And I can kind of show you in Scripture where I believe that, okay? But listen to this. The Bible says He's coming soon. He's coming soon. If you see what's going on in America today, not only America, if you see what's going on in the world today, hey, everybody hates Israel right now. Y'all don't realize that? Literally everybody hates Israel. I mean, Israel had no problems for a long time. Everybody loved them. Now all of a sudden, everybody hates them. I mean, and they didn't do nothing to nobody. Why? Because God said that's what's going to happen. God said that's what's going to happen. It wasn't a coincidence that all of a sudden everybody started hating Israel, because God said, they're not going to love my people. And that's God's chosen people, and the world hates Israel. The world absolutely hates them. Why? Why should our walk and our talk match? Because of the message of the second coming. Number three, why should they match up? Because our message of service to Christ. We need to persuade people to consecrate their lives to the Lord. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:55, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Thy sting of death and sin, the strength and sin of the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not vain in the Lord. It is because the measure of our service to Christ. Why should our walk and talk match up? Because the measure of our service to Christ. Listen to this. Why? Because you don't know how much longer you got to serve God. And listen to this. You don't know how much longer your health is going to allow you to do that. So you serve God when you got health. You serve God while you can jump around. You serve God when you can walk. You serve God when God can allow you to use your talents. You do all that you can do, and you give God everything that you got. And hey, we need to be an encouragement to people to serve God. We need to tell them how wonderful it is to serve God. We need to tell them how joyful it is to serve God. We need to tell them, hey, it's the greatest thing ever to serve God. And then having grandkids is second, praise God. Hey, we need to tell people how wonderful it is to serve God. That's why our walk and talk need to match up. That way people say, well, you don't look too joyful about serving God. It is a wonderful thing to serve God. It is a wonderful thing to lead someone to the Lord. It is a wonderful thing to help someone in Christ. It is a wonderful thing. And our message should be, and our walk and talk should match up together. Why? Because our service for Christ. I mean, we got to be steadfast. We got to be unmovable. We have to serve. And I tell you what was a blessing last week. Many of you brought in food items to the hurricane relief. And y'all backed up to that door, and we unloaded your stuff. And then Michael came, and we loaded that trailer up. And we took all that stuff over to East Tennessee and North Carolina. Why? Because your service, because you want to give back. And you know what? Our giving back should match up to our talk. If we say, oh man, I love people, well, show it. I want to help people, well, show it. Do what you're supposed to do. And I'm going to tell you this, if our talk and our walk match up about how much we love people, great and mighty things will be done. That's why we support missionaries. Why? Because there's people dying and going to hell all across this world. And when you give money to missions, what does it do? Does it sit in a bank account? No, it don't sit in a bank account. It goes to missionaries. Every dime of the missions monies that comes through this church, it goes to missionaries. It doesn't sit in a bank account. It doesn't draw interest. It goes to a missionary that needs those funds to stay on the field, to start churches, to pass out tracts, to lead people to Christ. There are missionaries that lead people to Christ that have never heard Christ. There's missionaries around this world that literally have to start from Genesis. They have to start. There's a God in heaven. There's a creator. And they have to work their way all through Genesis. They have to go through Exodus and talk about the Israelites. They had to go all through that. They had to talk about the sacrifices. Oh, but then all of a sudden, when they get to the book of Matthew and they talk about how that Jesus Christ was crucified on the cross of Calvary, how that Jesus was born as a servant, and he came down and lived 33 and a half years, and he died upon the cross of Calvary. And I watched a video one time where this missionary had been teaching this group of people. And I believe, I forgot where it was at, Papua New Guinea, I think. And he had got down to the book of Matthew, and they were okay. But then all of a sudden, it dawned on this group of people that their ancestors had died and gone to hell. And I'm telling you, they were crying. They were screaming. They were in pain. They said, oh, why didn't someone come sooner? Why didn't someone come sooner? And that is so important why we support missionaries. Why? Because we can get missionaries across the field. Listen, your service for Christ counts. You might be able to encourage, we got kids that ride this bus. You might be able to encourage someone that rides this bus to serve God. And I want you to see this, fourthly, and I'm done. The message of the source of our existence. Listen, we want to persuade others about the true Creator and the fact that God is the ultimate authority of the universe. I love this verse right here. Ecclesiastes 12:1, it says, remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, while the days are evil, come not, nor the years draw nigh, when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. The Bible says this in Colossians 1:16, for by him were all things created, in heaven and earth, invisible and invisible, whether it be thrones, dominions, or principalities, or powers, and all things were created by him and for him, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist. We need to tell people that the source of your existence is God himself. There's a lot of folks out there that only believe in God. And I'm going to tell you this. Our walk should match our talk. Why? Because there's a lot of people that have no faith in Christians. And why is that? Because they have met a lot of worldly, ungodly Christians that say they're Christians, and it don't match up. And they don't even believe God even exists, because how do you say God exists and you live one way and act another way? And I'm going to tell you this, listen to this. The measure of the source of our existence, the Bible says that God created everything. The Bible says that we should fear God with a holy and a reverent fear. And when you walk around and you do what you do, if you fear God with such a reverence, people will say, well, why are you doing that? Because I fear God. Because if we would get back to a fear of God in America, it would help us. And listen to this. Your walk and your talk should match up. Why? Because he created everything. And the Bible says that he might have the preeminence. And then I'm done. Listen to this. The Bible says, neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and give it light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. And what does that mean? That means you wrap it all up. Why? Because why do we walk and talk the same? Because people are dying and going to hell. Because as a Christian, there is a second coming. Number three, because we want to serve God. We want to give God everything we got. And number four, we want to exalt him because he made everything. And one day it's all going to go back to him, amen. And one day we're going to live with him forever. And I'm going to tell you this. There's going to be one day in heaven. Sometimes I think about what's going to happen. What are we going to do in heaven? I mean, I know what the Bible says. We're going to be shouting, praising God. But are we going to be thinking back about the lifespan that God gave us? Of that little dash between our birth and our death? That little dash in between? Are we going to be able to think about those things? Because the Bible says all tears will be wiped away. There's not going to be weeping in heaven. But are we going to be thinking about eternity, what we did upon this short time on earth? And you know what? It's just for a little time. Just for a little time. We might think it's a long time. I've met people that were 99 years old. I've met people that were 100 years old. I met a person that was 101 one time. And they said, man, it went by so quick. They said, man, it went by so quick. You know, I used to be a teenager. I used to be a skinny, 149-pound teenager. And now look at me. Don't say nothing, amen. And it went by just like that. And I go back home and I go watch these wrestling matches back home. And I watch these real skinny guys, and they'll say, and I have a couple of my guys I used to wrestle with. They'll say, "Hey, you want to go wrestle?" And I say, "Man, I'll get down there for 2.5 seconds and die." And I was like, "Man, but I remember the time, it seems like it was yesterday, when I could get on that mat and run forever. I mean, I could run forever. I could just do whatever I wanted to do." But you know what? Life is short. And I'm going to tell you, as a child of God, while you have air in your lungs, your heart is beating, let's just be real. And let's just do what's right. Because you know what? It's all going to be over one day. And hell's a real place. And oh, that we should be burdened for the souls of men. We also should be in the service of Christ. And I'm going to tell you this. If you, as the members of Fairhaven Independent Baptist Church, new visitors, just literally just say, "I want to be real. I want to do what I'm supposed to do." There's no telling what God can do in this little community and the communities around if we just do what we're supposed to do. And that's just love God, love His commandments, and does what He tells us to do. Oh, it'll be wonderful. Every head bowed, every eye closed as our piano player comes. What about you tonight? How long has it been since you said, "Lord, just help me to be what I'm supposed to be. Help me to be real. Help me to do your work. Help me to do everything that I'm supposed to do for you. Lord, give me a burden that people are dying and going to hell. And oh, how I know the need to love people and realize that hell's a real place." Do you realize that hell's a real place? If God saved your soul, you're not going to hell. But there's people around this world that is. People around Murfreesboro that's dying going to hell. And oh, I tell you this, they could use a gospel witness from you. So what about it? Does your walk match up your talk? To do what you're supposed to be doing? Oh, that's all He asked, is to do what you're supposed to be doing. Dear God, we thank You for this day You've given us. We thank You for loving us. Lord, I thank You for being so kind to us, so gracious to us. Lord, I pray that You'd help me, that my walk would match up with my talk, Lord God. Lord, that I would have a greater burden to see people saved. I would have a greater burden to see lives touched, Lord God. Lord, I pray that You'd help me to serve You with everything that I have, Lord God. Lord, help me understand that You're coming soon. And oh God, help me just to worship You for who You are. Oh, that You are a great Creator. Lord, help us to love You, to love You, to love You. And I pray all these things in Jesus' name. I do pray. Amen. So stand across the auditorium. What about it? The altar.